So we've discussed text, audio, image, and video. All these were initially built in silos. Over the last few years, labs have focused on merging these modalities together. The late 2010s saw the emergence of viable solutions like VideoBird and Visual GPT. Flamingo from DeepMind took it to another level with visual language models that could have conversations about images across different tasks. Now, there are models that can take several modalities and generate text, audio, heat maps, images, and more. They are called any-to-any models. Popular examples of such models are NextGPT and Meta's ImageVine. OpenAI's GPT-4V is one of the more popular multimodal models. However, as of now, it only accommodates text and images. One argument for the problems of LLMs is that they don't have access to more information around the world. Multimodality helps with this by assembling information in different formats and putting it all in one model. The AI model understands what a dog looks like, how it moves, and the sound it makes. This is known as positive transfer. On the other hand, there can be negative transfer, where the model starts to mix up information because there is a lot going on. A delicate mix of all modalities is what helps the model learn better. So let's close the chapter on multimodality and talk about AI agents. AI agents are virtual intelligent machines that perform a series of tasks to achieve a goal. For example, you can ask your AI to book a room on Airbnb or tell it to purchase some chemicals online for a secret project. Obviously, the complexity of these steps plays a big role. But there are also safety concerns, like in the case of purchasing chemical compounds online without the necessary approval. AI that can easily navigate the internet can prove to be a problem, and protections will have to be put in place to monitor such activities. The power of multimodality will help AI models analyze text online, navigate websites, and interact with them. Early projects from DeepMind and Adept AI worked on this vision. More companies have sprung up in the last few months that want to develop AI web agents. But the website isn't the only place we can have AI agents. Gaming is one of the biggest avenues for AI agents. Gaming is particularly important because it provides an open-world platform where AI agents can fully explore. Gaming provides a fantastic simulation for the real world, and AI agents can be tested in such environments before any forms of real development in the physical world, especially when it comes to robot design and deployment. We'll talk about this in the next few sections. Big game companies like Rockstar Games will adopt multi-agent AI characters to bring more life to the game.
Johnny, do you like ice cream?
There have also been other examples in the last few months of in-game characters having conversations with gamers. Imagine each NPC character having a great background story and never repeating the same set of actions or words. That would be absolutely incredible. Large AI models that provide quality output run on computers with huge processing power. The next level of access and usability for multimodal models is on devices. This means you can easily run models on mobile phones. There are already several advancements in this research field, with models like Llama 2 spearheading this. This means AI can be more personalized to your data without requiring access to huge cloud providers like Amazon and Microsoft. Everything runs solely on your phone. This helps with privacy to some extent and makes AI systems easily accessible. It's only a matter of time before we see a fully enabled AI-assisted Siri or Google Assistant. Not long ago, the newly formed startup, Rabbit, released R1, which is supposed to be an AI-assisted device that can do anything on your phone based on your commands. You can tell R1 to get you an Uber ride or schedule an appointment.
We want it to be universal, not just a Chrome plugin or a limited set of apps, but everything, iOS, Android, and desktop. Finally, we can build a computer that, in addition to understanding what you're trying to say, can actually help you do things on your behalf.
Playing Pocket Calculator by Kraftwerk for you.
It's a version of an AI agent that we previously discussed. This is like an improved version of Siri.
Play another song from the album.
The presentation seems amazing, sure. And the latency between command and action is seamless. I'm interested to see how fast its response time is when the product finally ships. Another feature is Teach Mode, where you can teach R1 a new task, like playing a song from Spotify by showing it how. Interesting issues to watch out for are how long it takes to fully understand what's required and how much complexity it can handle. Apple and Google are probably working overtime to ship a similar version on their phones later this year. I might cover the R1 when it finally comes out, so stay posted on this channel. LLMs, multimodality, and agents are amazing, and in the last 3 to 4 years, we've seen progress like never before. But for now, they can only act in the digital world. This is where the fusion of multimodal models and robotics comes into play. This way, we can have LLMs perform the planning, which then connects to a robot for execution. We've already seen early signs of this with LLM and autonomous driving, or LLM for robotic motion. Over the next few years, we'll see more of this marriage between the planning layer and actionable implementation in the real world. One that caught my attention was Alta 3 from the University of Tokyo, which enabled robotic movements from simple GPT-4 commands. Limitations in robotics are partly due to insufficient data the robots can learn from. We're starting to see a bit of progress in this area, with robots learning from vast amounts of data by generating synthetic data and quickly learning from that. Here's an example of Google's Rosie, which imagines different scenarios to help train it. We've discussed a few robot implementations in previous videos. You can check the links below for more detail. Obviously, we still have a ways to go before realizing this harmonious integration of robotics and AI. The first mass adoption of intelligent robots will be in factories, and over time, more cost-effective robots will be deployed in our homes, just like the Roomba. The big players like Tesla, Boston Dynamics, and Unitree from China are all implementing AI on different scales to achieve more general-purpose machines. In the age of AI, honest and factual news is paramount. As artificial intelligence systems get better at generating content across all media platforms, concerns about their dual use rises. We saw glimpses of this a few months ago when AI-generated photos of former President Trump were circulating. Or the picture of the Pope that got people second-guessing if he was indeed wearing a puffy winter jacket. We can only expect this to get worse. Somewhere in Maryland, a principal is claiming that derogatory statements that seem to have been made by him were actually synthetically generated. He claims that the students actually used his voice to generate such content. In the midst of misinformation and disinformation, confusion and unrest may spread. And hence, the 2024 US elections are a big marker on how things will unfold. There are already several attempts, including a fake Biden robocall in New Hampshire, meant to discourage voters.
It's important that you save your vote for the November election. Voting this Tuesday only enables the Republicans in their quest to elect Donald Trump again.
In this new era, it's important to question everything you read, watch, or listen to. Several labs are working on ways to detect AI-generated content, but none of them are foolproof. OpenAI released a blog specifically laying out their plans for the 2024 elections coming up. They plan to enforce strict usage policies as they continue to examine how their tool can be used for persuasion. Similarly, schools are enforcing ways to detect assignments that are generated using AI. The problem is they sometimes misclassify original work as AI-generated. Another interesting way AI is being used in media is by presenting the news through fake AI TV anchors with AI-assisted scripts and videos. Here's an example from Channel One News.
AI-generated stories and headlines, captivating visuals and data-driven insights. From global news to finance to entertainment, we'll show you how technology enables us to bring you a global perspective 24/7, right from the heart of our AI-native newsroom. All presented by our team of AI-generated reporters.
Things are moving ridiculously fast. Almost a year ago, I talked about Deep Brain AI when they first debuted a TV anchor in South Korea. The most vulnerable people during this time of AI and news will be individuals who are absolutely clueless about the advances in AI. Lately, I've been seeing a rise in fake ad content, mimicking popular online figures like Joe Rogan or MrBeast.
This is not Joe Rogan selling men's health supplements.
If you go to Amazon and you type in for men, you're gonna find it right at the top.
And it will only get worse. Here's one I captured on my phone during the course of editing this video.
Yeah, the app is on the main screen. Where'd you find it?
Brace yourselves and inform your loved ones to be on the lookout as we prepare for the storm of fake news that's about to hit us all. AI news doesn't only have to be images or voices. It can be plain old text. The New York Times is suing OpenAI and Microsoft for using their news articles to train their GPT models without the media company's consent. OpenAI claims their use of the model is considered under fair use. However, they plan to license news from media giants including CNN and Fox for between $1 million and $5 million. Some AI labs are putting the power of art generation back in the hands of artists. One such example is the University of Chicago's Nightshade tool, which helps artists prevent unauthorized AI scraping of their images. It's a free software that poisons AI models by making subtle pixel-level changes to images, which affects how AI systems perceive them. To the human eye, there's no difference, but to the AI model, there's a world of difference. This will help protect artists' rights and data integrity by preventing their work from being used to train AI without permission.
Landscape of how AI models get training data. And of course, the goal is that AI companies will actually go out and pay artists and real people to license their actual content, just like you would in any other industry.
The debate of data governance in AI-generated work is a big hurdle that has to be overcome. Policymakers are scrambling to find an answer. The EU is ahead of the pack by coming out with initial rules to govern the sector. Can AI-generated text, art, or voice be considered original work? To get to a constructive outcome, we would need a new definition for what originality means on a philosophical level. Government regulation is always a few years behind, and artificial intelligence progress is rapidly consuming all sectors. So there is indeed a real sense of urgency. It's difficult to truly understand what several of the giant AI companies are building. It's all a black box. Over the years, AI companies have released less and less information about how their models are built and the training data being used. In the New York Times case, they prompted ChatGPT and it regurgitated an entire article. That's the only way they found out. there are other companies like Meta and Hugging Face that are spearheading the open source movement and advocating for AI research to be more open and transparent. The argument for closed source models is that they provide companies with an edge over competition and also help these companies deploy in a safe manner. But who dictates what safety means? It's a pretty complex topic and one that deserves its own video. Every day, users are finding clever ways of getting past the guardrails in large language models. Here's an example of a jailbreak that convinces ChatGPT to write a text that encourages drunk driving. In another example, Anthropic's lab found that you can embed sleeper agents in LLMs to execute malicious code depending on certain keywords. If models are not deployed properly, then it's evident how this may be a problem in the future. OpenAI claims they're making attempts to deploy AI that aligns with human values so they don't go rogue on us in the future. They are awarding research grants to groups working on the alignment issue. And a few weeks ago, they published a paper on how future super AI agents may be supervised by humans. I'll link to the paper below so you can explore some of the interesting ideas and tests they ran. As competition gets intense among companies, each one is amassing chips on a large scale, making it difficult for smaller labs and educational institutions to keep up. Groups that lack sufficient processing power are jokingly called GPU poor. NVIDIA controls the GPU market and has been involved in the semiconductor war happening between the superpowers, mostly the USA and China. I discussed this briefly in a separate video that talked about how AI is playing a crucial role in wars across the world. Zuckerberg mentioned that Meta will have almost 600,000 equivalent GPUs of the H100s. That's a ridiculously large inventory for just one company. But considering the best AI models use a lot of computers, it all makes sense. Here's a picture describing the vastness of these models. It's based on very early rumors surrounding GPT-4 last year. It may not be precisely accurate, but gives you a sense of how large the models can get. Imagine about 7 million years worth of compute and 30,000 football fields for the hundreds of billion parameters the model uses. These numbers are outstanding. Companies want to reduce their over-reliance on NVIDIA for GPU chips. For example, OpenAI's Sam Altman is said to be seeking funding to create a supply chain of AI chips that can speed up the company's work. I've discussed this several times on the channel, but aside from improving model architecture and other details on the software side, hardware truly dictates how much computation power is possible. Over the years, there have been talks about introducing quantum computing into AI development. Quantum technology isn't where it needs to be yet, but just like how modern CPUs and GPUs scale deep learning to another level, so might quantum computing advance AI development to the next level. The jury is still out on that. There have been several AI predictions made for 2024. Most of them are very generic because, obviously, only seers like Nostradamus can get really specific with predictions. There are usually periods of calm activity before another huge technological impact. I think 2024 will be a buffer year, where we see gradual progress but very significant in the right direction. All in all, it's an exciting time in AI, and I'm looking forward to sharing the latest and wildest research topics with you. Like always, CES already previewed a lot of AI products at the top of the year, so that shows you what's already in store. We've barely scratched the surface in this video. However, you now have a general sense of the AI landscape for 2024 and beyond. Thanks for watching Beyond Today. Until the next video, it's goodbye.